It's good to see all of you through the camera that are watching. Yesterday, I had the privilege of meeting with several of our digital members through Christina's Magical Moments meetup. And one of them, Unique Sunflower, she was wearing a shirt that said something to the effect of happiness comes from within. And I thought, wow, she didn't know it, but that's related to what I'm going to be sharing with you today. So I would like to draw your attention to our title. Those of you who are on Facebook or YouTube, you've probably seen the title already. It is The Irreducible You, Realizing Who You Are and Not Thinking About It. Can you imagine that? The Irreducible You, Realizing Who You Are and Not Thinking About It. So let me begin by making what I would consider an irrefutable biblical Christ-centered statement. Now, I've shared some of these things before with you, but I put these together for my first stop in England, which was at All Nations Church in Keighley. And I really just felt like I needed to maybe retool this a little bit for our group and for those that are watching on YouTube and share with you from some other angles, but it basically comes from that message I shared almost 2 months ago now. Well, no, almost a full month ago now in Keighley, England. So as I started to say, let me begin by making what I would consider an irrefutable biblical Christ-centered statement. You do not need more of God. You do not need to be more holy. You do not need to be more righteous. You do not need to memorize more scripture. You do not need more of the Holy Spirit. Think that through. You do not need more of anything because everything you'll ever need is already within you. From the beginning, from Moses, who called this being God, from Jesus, who called our Father, this infinite creator said that you and I are his image and likeness, according to Genesis 1:26. Isn't that true? For that matter, Jesus never said anything to the contrary. Modern religious systems, however, have told us that we are sinners separated from God because of the fall, but Jesus consistently told us otherwise. So rather, consider this. To the misbelieving, religious, law-abiding, ritual-upholding, scripture-memorized Pharisees, who, when reading the Gospels, would be considered Jesus' nemesis, Jesus said this. Check this out. We've heard this scripture quite a few times before, but I think it bears repeating. Now, when he was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them and said, "The kingdom of God does not come with observation." I want you to remember that for a second. "Nor will they say, 'See here' or 'See there,' for indeed the kingdom of God is within you." I guess we can't stress this enough, because while we believe this, understand something, belief can be very two-dimensional. Because we believe it, that's not how we practice reality. So consider, at the time Jesus spoke those words, approximately 2,000 years ago, the religious understanding at the time was that there was a God who ruled in a prescribed moral holiness in a place called heaven, and we were sinful people on earth that must offer sacrifices to stay his judgments and plagues because of them. We were also to give offerings and sacrifices with proper ritual, along with unquestioned obedience, to acquire blessings as well. It was understood we were mere humans, whom at one time may have been the image and likeness of God, but that was before we fell into sin. At that time, what was the common understanding was this, what I just shared with you. And in many cases, that belief may still hold true today for many people. We've just had a change in the cast of characters to fit Christendom. What that has done, though, is redefine the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus to match that belief system. Despite such beliefs, when Jesus came on the scene, he attempted to reboot the notion about who we were and who God was. Of course, this is what religious leaders of the day considered heresy, and which would ultimately get Jesus murdered. The heresy that Jesus taught is far better first explained by what it is not. Jesus was not saying, if you follow me, pray the right salvation prayer, and do all the right things based on a new set of rules I give you, the kingdom of God will come to live inside you, and you will be saved from God's wrath. No. Rather, Jesus was telling people, consider, who did not follow him, nor believe his message, and in this case, the apparent nemesis, the Pharisees, that the kingdom of God was within them. That's the context of that verse. If you notice, it opens with, now when he was asked by the Pharisees, the context is the Pharisees to whom he was speaking, that indeed the kingdom of God was within them. And if anything, in our biblical narrative, the New Testament narrative, the Pharisees were the opposite of thought than who Jesus was. But Jesus was saying, despite what you think, the kingdom is within you. By saying that, the ramifications and the rippling effects were massive. The implications of what he said and to whom he said it broke open the potential realization that whatever sin you think you committed hasn't separated you from God, or what religious beliefs you've held. In fact, despite those beliefs, the infinite creator resides within and permeates everyone. In addition to this, Jesus prefaces all this by saying the kingdom of God doesn't come with observation, nor will they say see here or see there. What does that mean? Let me give you an idea. It means the kingdom of God, when Jesus says the kingdom of God doesn't come with observation, listen to this phrase. The kingdom of God doesn't come through objective experience. Rather, the reality of whom Moses called God and Jesus called Father comes through being aware that the eternal creator is within us and we are an emanation and expression of that creator. In other words, it's the opposite that what most of us, here's the word, think. Think of the subtitle of this, realizing who you are and not thinking about it. You and I, including those Pharisees and non-believers, are an emanation of the infinite creator. We are an expression of that very, quote-unquote, being. Remember that word. But when we look to God, hear me out, when we look to God, or to whom Jesus called Father, we are seeking an external experience. We live in the illusion, then, we don't even realize it, that we are separate from God. And for that matter, separate from each other. You'll find that through the New Testament, the language of separation seems to be present, but it's not there for a doctrinal statement. It's used to address those who believe in the illusion that we are separated. Most of the time, I'm going to say this first before we go any further about the word illusion. Hear me. Most of the time when we consider the word illusion, we think of something that doesn't exist. It's an illusion. That's not the dictionary definition nor how I'm using it. The word illusion is a misinterpretation. This is the dictionary definition now. A misinterpretation of things that exist. an erroneous perception of reality. The result of misinterpreting things that exist and embracing an erroneous perception of reality leads us to live in a world of illusion with many delusions about ourselves, others, and most importantly, that which we call God. Jesus is very clear to his disciples and to us in removing this illusion of separation. There are three verses here. The first one, John 10:30, I and my Father are one, no separation. John 14:9, notice it's building to something. He who has seen me has seen the Father. Okay? And then, of course, John 17:21, that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us. And the Greek word there that I'm showing you, which we could talk about further in a little bit, is not so much about may be one as if they are not and shall be. It means that we exist as one. It's about realizing it. In the Creator's reality, we're already one. He is we. We are he. He is me. Me is we. We are he, and we are all one. Hope that made sense. Don't ask me to repeat it. I am the cuckoo cuckoo, Brian. I am the walrus. That's good. It's us who must change our keyword thinking. Or to use another New Testament word, metanoia. We've talked about this before, which we use erroneously as repent. And just for those of you, maybe it's your first time watching, just to say this, metanoia or repent, we talk about repenting from sin. We talk about repenting from this or repenting from that. In Jesus' case, he says, we translate, repent, the kingdom of God is here. Repent really is coming through a Latin word, which we would translate, or you may have heard of, penance, which means to do something as a restitution or a form of saying you're sorry to God for a sin or something wrong that you did. That's penance. And in our religious tradition, even in Christianity, some of our penance really became a pretty ugly thing. I mean, we've had people climbing up marble stairways on their knees to the point that they bleed to prove how sorry they are, or flogging themselves to the point that they bleed to prove how sorry they are. That's the word penance. Sadly, our translators retranslated, if you will, rather than using penance in the name of Protestantism, to repent, which basically means to do penance over again. Still got to feel super sorry. Flog yourself, if not physically, emotionally. That means you've repented. But actually, it's the Greek word metanoia, which means put in the center of your thinking. That's all it means. But in one respect, it's a lot more profound than flogging yourself. Because putting in the center of your thinking, especially when you thought otherwise, means to change the way you think. And as a result, I've now centered my thoughts. So this is a key aspect, to center ourselves, or as some would say, center your mind. The Apostle Paul used the phrase in Ephesians and in Romans to renew the mind. Really, a better translation for renew means to renovate or restore. The point is, it is not renewing your minds to something that hasn't existed before and is therefore now new. Actually, it is renewing or renovating backs to whatever that is, that's something, you know, a piece of furniture. I'm going to renovate it. What am I going to do? I'm going to restore it back to its luster, back to its original beauty and its function. So what are we restoring it back to compared to where we are? If we believe that renewing the mind is that we get something new, something we haven't had before, guess what? We would still be looking for our spiritual life and mind in objective experience. and that's impossible. Rather, what Paul exhorts us to do is to restore our mind to its ever-present awareness of our true eternal self. I say that again. It's to restore our mind to its ever-present awareness of our true eternal self. Let's talk about two things before we hone in on our key point. First, what makes us an actual emanation of God or the very likeness of God? One attribute, talked about this before, is called choice. Consider this verse of scripture. 1 John 4:7-8 says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love." That is such a profound verse. Thank you, Apostle John. And yes, we can sit on "for God is love." That it doesn't say God has love. It says that he is love, which now means anybody who truly loves is functioning in a God dynamic, whether they're conscious of it or not. Please note, if God the Father or the eternal infinite creator created us in his image, then our true identity is love. Our eternal living being is love. Most of us think of love as something we feel with qualification. How many times we hear people say, "God will bless you because he loves you." So we start looking for the blessings to validate God's love. If blessings are absent, we assume we either were what? Doing something wrong, right? Or not doing something right enough, and therefore maybe not lovable enough. How many times we hear people relate those ideas in this way? Obedience to God will bring blessings, but when we are disobedient, it will bring judgment and open the door to demonic attack or the devil. So we gauge our obedience based on whether good or bad things are happening in our lives. But based on that system of thinking, confusion arises along with emotional fears and insecurity. When we think, keyword think, when we think either we or a friend, who was the obedient servant, by the way, all of a sudden some calamity happens. It's then our so-called prayer life transforms into spiritual negotiation. We've talked about this before. "Father, you know how faithful Sister Mary was. She attended church faithfully. She didn't leave her husband even though he abused her because she was believing God for his soul, etc. To deliver her from this situation, she was a faithful woman." In other words, based on our thinking of Mary and God, Mary should have enough spiritual capital, like poker chips, to leverage God to move in her behalf. Now, if this approach doesn't work, then we think we need to remind God what his promises are. So now we start quoting to God his words, right? So we try leveraging God based on holding him accountable to his word. Think about this. The problem is neither of these gain results to our liking many times. We assume either Sister Mary really didn't have enough spiritual capital to gain her healing, or God, who's supposed to keep his word, is selective on how he does that. Or there are other versions of negotiation and methods that we devise, calling such things as steps to answered prayer, right? Pull this lever, right? And pull this chain, pull this lever, you know, dial this in, and God, he's got no choice. Would you say that a little louder? The algorithm of grace. The algorithm of grace. There you go. That's a good message title right there. or we acquiesce to the resolution that God is sovereign and he can do what he wants because he has a plan we don't understand. Herein is the issue with all these conclusions. They arise from a thinking based on objective experience, not spiritual insight. Now, we can come back to that phrase later, but I just want to say this. Insight, inside, insight, that which is something within. The kingdom is within, not objective, right? It's internal. It's within us. This is the gateway to the eternal right here. Some of us, when this is pointed out, we realize something's a bit amiss. But rather than seek further enlightenment, we try to clean up such egocentric transactional beliefs by trying to balance God's love and judgment. So we say things like, well, only God knows what he's doing. Just remember, God loves the sinner but hates the sin, which is another leap in thinking. Consider what's interesting about such two-dimensional binary statements is that we can't separate God's judgment upon the sin from judging the sinner. So how does that really work out then? Thus, we think of the notion that God is love, but we do so through, again, objective experience. Keep in mind, just because we say God's love is unconditional doesn't mean we really think that. Consider the next time you talk to whom you think God is, or whom you think the divine Father is that we think Jesus was speaking of, if somewhere in the discussion a negotiation or leveraging arises. However, despite our beliefs in divine reality, it's truly this. We are love. And objective experience has nothing to do with it. With that in mind, it also explains how most of us love because we don't love from a place of choice, hear me now, but from a place of condition. I love you because you give me this or that. I love you because of how you make me feel, in other words. Now, all of a sudden, it's back to objective experience. It's back to condition. So you could say our love comes from a root in the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, not from divine choice. Again, we try to explain this from a standpoint. God loves us unconditionally, but God... Honestly, if it's followed by but God, anything that comes after it negates the notion of unconditionality. From the divine perspective, the central aspect that makes love love is choice. However, this choice to love is not rooted in negotiation, leveraging, and conditions, despite the fact that we may claim it's unconditional. It's really interesting how God's got unconditional love, but he will blow up an entire nation because there's some sin there. And it's like years ago, I was on a television program, here in the city, and I was asked by the host what I thought about, and maybe I've shared this before, but what I thought about these hurricanes that hit Florida. Not that we haven't been through them recently again. Because at that time, a particular, I'll say well-meaning, but highly misinformed, television minister said that the reason why these hurricanes came to Florida was because there's a very large gay community there, and that was the judgment of God. My challenge is God, who seems to have very precise judgment, has really imprecise aim. Okay? Because not only did this hurricane come, it missed the gay community just a little bit. It was a bit, I think, north of it. And the county that wound up getting decimated included a bit of the gay community, but all this, quote, non-gay community. What does that mean? I mean, There are, and I guarantee you also there were some non-gay people living in the gay community and probably some gay people living in the, you know, and I mean, come on. You see, this choice of love I'm speaking of is not based on negotiation, leveraging, and conditions, right? Despite the fact that we may claim it's unconditional. Rather, it's based on the Creator's nature. The essence of who he, she, they, if you're a Trinitarian, right, are. The Creator that Jesus and the apostles spoke of, who Jesus called Father, is complete, limitless love. Another way to say unconditional love by virtue of one's nature is selfless love. It's not egoistic. It's not self-centered. It's not selfish. Which now comes to the first point of the two that I was mentioning earlier. Consider, because we're an emanation of the Creator, that means we too, in essence, are selfless love. When we're being love by nature, we are being our authentic self, being the Father's or God's image and likeness. Because we deal with the illusion of the fabricated egoistic self, that false separate self that we talked about, that we created egoistically, our existence becomes thinking and evaluating reality by objective experience. To add to that, there's no such thing as selfless, unconditional love in objective experience. When we move into the realm of selflessness, objective experience melts into the infinite awareness of who we are. So what do I mean by that? Realizing who you are and not thinking about it. Because as we've said before, you've heard me say it before, we are not our thoughts and feelings, but an observer of them. The issue is, how do we describe the observer from what it thinks about its thoughts? So it kind of comes to this famous, I put this picture together. If you notice on one side of the tree here, there's the serpent face. On the other side is kind of like a beautiful sunrise. And the idea was this, for all of us, even though we say there are two trees, there's only one. And it's the place you live from. You can either believe there's an evil side and a good side, or the reality is it's one tree, which is called the tree of life, and I've deluded myself into believing there's an evil and a good side. So consider this. Matthew 6:25, Jesus says these words, "Therefore I say to you, take no thought." Merimnate, take no thought, means focused thought. Don't focus on the thought and start thinking about it. For your life, suke, which is breath, we'll get back to that, what you shall eat, what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what you shall put on. Notice these are all objective experience things. Is not life more than meat and the body more than raiment? Consider, Jesus said, take no thought, right? In other words, don't think about your thoughts. Don't think, Jesus would have never told you to do something you're not capable of. The problem is egoistically we have identified ourselves as that being rather than the observer. The fact you can observe your thoughts and you can observe whether you're thinking about them. Now that doesn't necessarily mean, well, I'm going to stop thinking altogether. The issue is, what thoughts are you thinking about and how are you thinking? What is the root from which, thank you, unique sunflower, right? From which you're thinking. The challenge is, rather than being the observer, we take thoughts by thinking about them and assume our thinking is us. I know this may not make sense, but let's try this experiment for a moment. Can you remember the time you fell in love? Or can you remember a time you had such joy in a particular moment where you couldn't even speak? Have you ever been there? Okay. If you can remember such a moment, the moment it happened, again, I'm speaking of being in the moment of that love or joy. I'm not talking about after it happened. I'm not talking about a day later, but in that moment. Can you remember that moment? Guess what? You weren't thinking when that happened. You were being. When that love occurred, when that joy happened, you weren't thinking, now I'm going to, I should be joyful about this. Yeah, this is a good thing. No, you were overwhelmed by that. You were being joy. You were being love. The thinking came after most of the time. And in some cases, because of how we think, we talk ourselves out of the joy and peace of the moment, and we talk ourselves into objective experience again, thinking about, that was great. Now I need to seek another happy moment. I need to try to get happy again. I need to try to experience that joy again. Sometimes we follow certain religious leaders because we may have had a joyful moment in their service, and now we're going back to try to find that joy again, because we started thinking about it. Understand something. There's a difference between being and thinking. When our thinking comes from that place of joy, comes from that place of love, that takes a whole different aspect of the thought. But most of the time, our thinking then is the evaluation through egoistically on how we either gonna hold on to that joy or how we're going to get it back. Because honestly, the second you think about it egoistically, you lose the joy. Why do I say that? The translator then adds, for your life, suke. Remember that? The word breath, right? So this verse may be better read this way. Therefore, I say to you, take no focus on the thought for your breath, what we shall eat, what we shall drink, nor yet for your body, what we shall put on. Is not breath more than meat and the body more than raiment? In Hebraic perception, the breath is a depiction of the Creator, our source of life, the Father, the essence of who we are, because we are that in image and likeness. The Hebraic concept is that if we are alive and breathe effortlessly, then that what we breathe is unchangeable and unconditional love, which gives life. Does that make sense? Consider, we can't change the natural breathing process naturally. If you try to stop breathing on your own and hold your breath, you are going to fail. You'll eventually take that much needed breath, or you'll pass out and start breathing anyway. On the other hand, the only way to stop the natural breathing process is to either change the content of what you're breathing externally, or externally hinder how you breathe. In both cases, you will either hinder or impede your ability to live fully, or just simply die completely, right? Well, think of it this way. When we live from an egoistic, self-centered, conditional love by way of thinking, we have either impeded our ability to live life the way we were designed, or we're truly the walking dead. You could say that most of humanity, because we do live from that tree of knowledge of good and evil, egoistic, serpentine thinking, evaluating reality through objective experience, and impose then our subjective memory on those experiences. You follow it? There's a lot there, but think that through, okay? We are living right now the zombie apocalypse, and we're all a part of it. So herein is the point. There is a difference between thinking and being. Understand, thoughts arise because humanity is all connected. We're all connected. So thoughts are there. Understand, thoughts arise because we're connected. The issue is, where do the thoughts originate from? Because our life-giving breath comes from the Creator's breath, Genesis 2:7. Once again, our breath and their breath are one and the same. His breath is our breath. His life is our life. We are one. So once again, we're back to Jesus saying, I'm in the Father, the Father's in me, and we are in you, and you are in us, past, present, and future. Thus, the sensation of thoughts that arise from love, joy, peace, etc., arise from your true self. Our divine self. The challenge is, when we egoistically start thinking about such, we limit and talk ourselves into finding them externally rather than internally. The kingdom is within you, not outside of you. And even though, yeah, but isn't it in that person over there? Yes. But the kingdom in them is also in you, which now means they're in you and you're in them, which was Jesus' point. Let's consider this. Most of us see and experience this existence from the standpoint of the boat. The sea has waves. We have a fire to put out on the boat. And when we look up, there's a very strong cloud cover. And behind the clouds is the Creator, the Father, the source of all, who is the sun in the blue sky. Occasionally, we pray. We get a breakthrough. The light breaks through the clouds. But this is not reality. This is actually our egoistic knowing of good and evil and living by objective experience. The serpentine tree of death, if you will, our false fabricated self. This is how we take objective experience and think about it. So that's where we are. We're on this boat. We got a fire to put out. We look up. We know God is in the heavens. Notice it's all external. And even still, how many of us, I'm challenging you next time you're in a prayer meeting of some kind, see how much negotiation, see how much leveraging, see how much external concepts of God occur. This is the process of our thinking. But actually, reality looks like this. So here is our normal way of thinking, we're on the boat looking up, when actually it's more like this. We are the sun and sky, radiant with love, joy, expressing life. To put it in other words, we are love, joy, peace. Jesus, does this sound familiar? Right? Galatians 5. This is our true, eternal, unchanging, irreducible self. You cannot reduce this infinite being we call God, who Jesus called Father. You can't reduce him into some nice little package. It's eternal, limitless. Well, guess what? You're in that same image, meaning you are eternal, you are limitless, you are irreducible as well. Regardless of what we think about it, we are the sun and the sky. It doesn't change its radiant expression, whether there are clouds or not. Even if it was the darkness of night, the sun is still shining. True? We'll find that as the earth turns on its axis, oh my goodness, the sun has been where it always has been. the waves are, if you will, our thinking, and the fire on the boat is how we think about it. The issue is, how are we going to think about those thoughts that come through of cloud cover, egoistically speaking, of cloud cover, etc.? How do we do this? What do we do? Do we think on the basis of our true unchanging self? Or do we think about this egoistic, we try to reduce the fact that, well, love is just, I felt love yesterday, but now my wife is really angry at me because of this. Well, shoot. Yeah, I love you, all right. You know, right? All of a sudden the conditions shoot in because I'm thinking about it now. Well, if she really loved me, she would meet my needs. Or if he really loved me, he would meet my needs. Or if they really, on and on and on we go. Consider how negative thoughts present themselves. The issue is how we think about them that creates our suffering. Recently heard something I thought was really good. I've said this for years, that the statement by I believe it was Descartes that said, I think, therefore I am, which is a false statement. You am, period. Okay? You am. Say what? You am. But actually, I think, therefore I suffer. It's all about thoughts, you know, the word of God, we usually say, which is the divine thought. That thought, love, joy, peace, etc., those thoughts are the creative fabric of everything. When we embrace those thoughts and be them, what produces out of that is the type of thinking that's creative. So we create works of art, philosophies, all kinds of things come out of that. But when we are not being who we are, we're then thinking about what we're not most of the time. Well, you're saying, Dr. John, that, you know, I'm love, but boy, I can do some pretty hateful things. So you just talked yourself out of who you are because you're thinking about it. You make it sound so easy. Try it. Try it. You know, meditation, which for many of us, meditation is something we do, right? Actually, meditation is something you don't do. When you're meditating, you're trying not to think. You're embracing the reality of who you really are. That's really the goal of meditation, is to not do, but to be. But if we decide to take fear and anxiety by thinking on them, we wind up putting a cloud cover over who we truly are. So here's the choice. It's not about, do you choose to love or do you choose to fear, which is the opposite of love. Hate is another category. Okay, think this through. You can't choose to love, because when you've done that, it's now outside of you. It's now something I have to choose to do. No, the difference is, am I going to choose to be who I really am? Or am I going to choose to continue to live in this fabricated, egoistic, self-centered, evaluation, negotiation world? Soon as I choose to be who I am, which is love, the other choices are already made. To say it another way, our experience in this world is like the boat on the waters. There may be a cloud in the sky, waves on the sea, and the occasional fires to put out on the boat. But that's not who we are. That's just what we experience. we, like Jesus, are one with the infinite eternal creator. This is the irreducible you. You are eternal. You are never ending and always shining. The light of the sun, if you will, like in the picture, regardless of the weather, you are life and love, just like the source you emanate. And that's really a key here. You are that which observes the thoughts that come or the thoughts that you are. And you have the ability to choose what you're going to focus on. In the same way, it applies to emotion. Remember who you are. When you genuinely experienced love and joy and peace, you didn't conjure up the energy to think about such things to make them happen. Oh, I got to be more joyful. I got to be more joyful. Forget it. You're done. You're done already. I got to have more faith. I got to have more faith. I got to have more faith. Stop. Well, if I just say the verse enough, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. It's all external, exactly. And actually, we're at that point denying the reality of who we are. All of us have felt love. All of us have experienced joy, maybe even sometimes peace. And many times it was because the certain external things that we're constantly looking for kind of lined up. And for that moment, we were just being. We weren't thinking about trying to get my life circumstance in order so I can be peaceful. That state of being, said it before, is who you are. Now consider this. When you start thinking and observing externally what's happening, stop yourself. Stop for a minute, because you can stop thinking. I promise you, count out loud from 1 to 100. At some point, you're going to stop thinking about whatever your situation is. You can't focus on all these things all at once. We're very fast. Don't get me wrong. We may think we can focus on 3 or 4 things all at the very same time, but it's actually not at the same time. Sometimes it's milliseconds. We're firing back and forth. But if you will stop for a moment, just say, okay, wait, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and the brain starts going, I want to think about it. No, stop. Yeah. I'm making a kind of a joke, but about counting. My point is you can stop thinking for a minute and you can evaluate the source where those thoughts are coming from. Are they coming from the external egoistic self, or is that coming from love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness, faith, and temperance, etc., to quote the King James Version? Keep it simple. Is it coming from love? If the answer is no, stop it. Stop it. And for some of us, this may be something we're going to be doing for a bit. But we can be intentional about it. And here's the thing. It's not an egoistic thing to rest. Somebody, were you singing about, who sang? Somebody said something about rest earlier. Mitzen. That was, I think, another one of the Holy Spirit moments where we're all on the same page. This is about resting. This is not, I'm now going to not think about it. I'm now not going to think about it. I remember in Bible college, 40 some odd years ago, maybe even longer than that, Dr. Bill Kaiser was teaching on love. And he said, for example, I want everybody for a moment to think about strawberries. So everybody, have maybe a mental picture or the word strawberry in their mind, whatever, however you think. And then he says, okay, now for the next minute, I don't want you to think about strawberries. What do you think you're going to do? Think about strawberries. That's why it's almost amusing to preach about sin, because the very thing you're not supposed to be thinking about, you're thinking about. God never said, I rebuke you, darkness. He's just said, light be. 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 Not just our worship leader. Be. Be who you truly are. Say, well, I'm trying to figure it out. Am I a doctor? Am I an artist? What am I? That's later. It starts from who you are as an emanation of this infinite, intelligent, universal, rooted in love being who Jesus called Father, the source of all. You are that. You can't change that any more than you can hold your breath and stop breathing. It's a reality. Some of us, the way we get, how many of us have, quote, come to Christ because of crisis? What is that like? Well, I've been trying to live in this kind of death hold of holding my breath and not breathing the way I naturally should. And I collapsed. And I started breathing. That's what, when we had the calamity to the point where we came to, quote, the end of our egoistic self, it's like the zombie apocalypse in our life just fell over. And guess what? It took its first breath in a long time and started breathing again. To use Jesus's words again, the kingdom of God, which is limitless and eternal, is within you. To make it more emphatic, or maybe a more of a modern flair, it's not that the kingdom of God is within you, because even the way that sounds in our modern sense seems to imply there's a you and then there's something else in you, which still denoting separation. So how about we translate it this way? The eternal, limitless kingdom of God is you. That is the irreducible you. So consider, you don't need more of. Actually, you need less of. John the Baptist said, he must increase, I must decrease. Well, guess what? Jesus never increased in that respect. God doesn't increase. How does limitlessness increase? How is that which is eternal get confined? It doesn't. Rather, it's an illusion, a misinterpretation of what is. So consider the irreducible you is realizing who you are and not thinking about it. Don't qualify. You are love. Don't qualify it. Don't think about it in the sense of egoistically evaluating it. If you're going to think, let love create the thoughts for you. Let joy create the thoughts for you. Now you're a creator. Think about it. For those of you who write poetry, or you maybe paint, or even a computer programmer, or a musician, I'm thinking in the arts for a minute because that's obvious, but this applies to engineering, it applies to all these stuff. When you're in that moment of writing or creating that song, you're not thinking. What you're really doing is you're pulling from a creative place, and now the mind is serving that place as opposed to the mind telling that place how it's going to live. Make sense? You are irreducible because you are infinite love, like the one who created you. Have a spectacular day.